What's up, everyone? I'm here with Jeremy with ROA Energy, and this is not a car. We've been looking at cars all day, but this does pique my interest because were you at this at the conference the last couple days?
Nope.
You weren't.
I just showed up for today.
So EVs also pretty good race cars, but they often don't have any way to charge at the track. So is this some sort of way to charge things when there's no other way to do it?
That's the idea, yeah. So it's a fully grid independent mobile EV charging station. So it's powered primarily by the solar here on the panels. Also has a wind turbine that's attached to it as well. It's got its own onboard battery storage and its own inverter cluster here in this cabinet that powers a level 2 J1772 plug. So it's
that's
ready to
so
charge
cool.
anywhere you want, right?
Can
fully
we,
grid independent.
Let's look around at the different components here. So this is the charging, and then you have your adapter there if you're charging a Tesla, right?
Yeah, got an additional Tesla adapter.
And then here's the solar panel.
Admittedly a bit dirty solar panel, so encountered some rain on the way down here. But
so it holds up to rain,
nice.
That's good.
It holds up to rain, holds up to hail, yeah.
How big is this panel?
So this is actually two solar modules here. Both of them are 400 watt nominal. They're bifacial monocrystalline PERC cells. These are made by Philadelphia Solar. The actual half cells on them were actually made in Japan. So, but yeah, these are really high quality panels and I got them for a pretty nice price, I think.
Okay, so each panel is 400 watt, you said?
Each panel is 400 watt nominal, yeah, so 800 watt total. This is actually a single axis tracking system. So you might actually see this panel adjust itself as we're talking.
Okay.
Over here, there's a sensor that's actually sensing the solar radiation from both sides of the panels. And it's attached to an actuator that's going to automatically adjust the panels to face the sun directly. Again, with solar panels, you want to get the best angle to maximize your solar gains. And that's really the idea here, is to pull as much power as we can out of a small parking space sized area.
So this is maybe a layman's question, but if this array is 800 watts, does that mean if it is out in the sun, say middle of the day, perfect conditions for an hour, that's 0.8 kilowatt that is going into the pack?
Yeah, 0.8 kilowatt hours is the idea there. Yeah, yeah. So every hour, multiply your wattage by an hour. Easy math. Right?
Okay, sweet.
Yeah. But the idea is it slowly charges itself sitting out in the sun, right?
What does the nominal mean when you say that it is nominal?
Sure, at least, again, in perfect sun, with perfectly clean panels, with perfect solar angle, you're going to get that much power,
That's
right?
like yeah. best case scenario.
Best case scenario, right? And of course, there's different ways you can have sort of not the highest power input. Again, it's all free power, though. It's
That's
clean.
Right.
It comes from the sky. So sometimes you sort of just take your solar gains and you keep stashing it away. And the way you stash it away is in the battery pack that's on underneath the panels here.
Save it for a rainy day. Quite
Save
literally.
It for a rainy day, exactly. Yeah. So.
Oh,
this
wow.
is a custom battery pack in here.
Okay.
LFP batteries in here.
How big is that pack?
So this is 60 kilowatt hours.
60 kilowatt hour pack.
Yeah, yeah. So it takes its sweet time recharging itself, but it's ready to immediately discharge into a vehicle. So again, this is sort of like an inverted sizing sort of method that I did. Usually people build out the panels way more, right? The panels are cheap, the batteries are expensive.
Sure.
So in this case, I opted to build a really large battery pack with a smaller solar array that would charge itself slowly, but then be ready to discharge into a vehicle.
What is data like this being used to calculate?
So this is actually to complement the actuator. So as you can see, you got an angle on the panels here.
Yeah.
If you had really strong wind gusts coming in from this side, you could have the trailer sort of pivot. It could lift, potentially roll over. So the idea here is this is sensing high winds. High winds, the actuator controller actually knows to level the panels out to reduce that potential failure mode. So this is really an insurance policy here. Yeah.
That makes good
sense.
That's
the idea.
So in a car, when you have like, say, a 100 kilowatt hour pack, you don't usually really want to keep it all the way up to 100%. You want to maybe keep it at like 80, 90, so I keep mine at 70, and then you probably want to charge it before it gets too low. Mm-hmm. Is this the same sort of thing with these batteries?
It is in some ways, at least they are lithium ion cells, they are going to degrade. At the same time, these LFP prismatic cells are rated to go from their sort of full charge all the way to full discharge. I'm still deciding what depth of discharge I want to sort of keep it at for its longevity.
Yeah.
But the goal is, of course, to get as much life as I can out of these batteries. That said, I am discharging these batteries much slower than an EV. An EV is sort of pulling a lot more current, a lot faster, and it's still at high voltage. This is going to be at lower voltage, but we're still not pulling that much that the cells could still provide more. And that's sort of because of the limitations of the inverters, unfortunately. I didn't go and get the really high-powered inverters. So it can only sort of pull a certain amount for the charger.
Okay, interesting.
Yeah, yeah. The batteries are able to provide much more current, but I'm sort of treating them really nice.
That's always good.
Not stressing them out too much.
Yeah. Do you have like instrumentation and software built in to be able to like get data over long term mm-hmm. of how mm-hmm. it's all working?
Yeah. At least if we want to step over and take a look at the inverter cluster.
And this, I guess, is where the magic happens.
Yes, this is the brain. We saw the belly, now we get to see the brain.
And would it be accurate to say that this kind of sits between the solar panel and the battery pack itself?
It does, right? Yeah. So these are two GrowWatt hybrid inverters. So these are fully off-grid, set up in a split-phase configuration to provide the level 2 charging voltage. So one of these inverters is also the solar charge controller. It's an MPPT classic solar charge controller that's taking the input from the solar panels and then bringing it to the correct voltage for the batteries.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah. So both of these inverters are connected to this orange pie here. So this is pre-programmed with software from Solar Assistant, which is a classic software that people use for DIY at-home solar photovoltaic installs. So this is that's the way that I get sort of remote monitoring, remote data logging, and I can sort of track the usage and look at different charging profiles, potentially diagnose potential problems.
Oh, interesting. So yeah. That you would hook up a laptop to that to be able to get the data?
Actually, it's all through the cloud. So this here is industrial cellular router. So I can connect to this anywhere. This has antennas that, while in the box, are still able to connect remotely. So I can actually pull this up with a little web browser on my phone, on a laptop, anywhere I go. This also has a tracking system with this router. It's a GNSS system. So I can also track it through this router, and I have an additional sort of dummy tracker that I'm able to use just in case of theft or loss, right?
That's very cool.
Yeah. Yeah, I spent a lot of time and money putting this together, and I don't want to lose it, right?
And yeah. I'm guessing this is a product that you're selling, and you might have customers who want to opt into that like kind of remote support, potentially.
At least I'm actually not looking to sell these.
Oh, you aren't? This is just...
Yeah, at least for now, admittedly, this is the one that I have, so I'm not looking to sell this. This is still sort of a prototype that I'm looking to show off, looking to get some interest. But the idea is this is a rental. This is like, for lack of a better term, a porta potty for EV charging. If you have an event, a race, a festival, some sort of situation or temporary event, temporary need for EV charging in a place that has no grid service or just doesn't have enough, you would want to use something like this instead of spending the time and energy and the money to install a traditional grid-fed EV charging station. So this is like a mobile charging station for rent. It's a pop-up service. When it's not needed anymore, we take it away to the next customer. So that's the business model that I'm looking to do.
Yeah.
If people end up deciding they want to buy these and keep them for themselves, then that might be the way that I
deal with it when you get there.
But I'm still figuring out that business side of it, I'll admit.
So where would people find you if they wanted to rent this?
Yeah, at least I'm at ROA Energy on socials, and ROA-energy.com is my website.
Okay.
Yeah, there's a little contact link in there.
When you were putting this all together, going from kind of the digital design, the paper, if you will, into what we see here today, was there any big surprises along the way?
Yeah, at least sort of space constraints. As you can see, I ended up having to put more and more components into smaller feeling boxes, right? And that's really the challenge with a lot of electronics, is to make sure that you have sort of like the right bending radii for wires and the right distances between pieces. So I was able to make this work, but it was sort of like finicky from the start. Yeah, at least you start and you just have this big empty box and you're like, oh, there's plenty of space. And then you start filling it up and then the space sort of disappears. But yeah, at least one other big challenge was I was working mostly by myself. I was working at a makerspace in Longmont called the Tinker Mill, which helped me out a lot. But admittedly, I'm still a one-man show. So sort of figuring out how I could get this set up by myself as much as I could, and then getting input and sort of additional hands when I needed it, that was a challenge as well.
Once it was working, how did it function? Did it exceed your expectations about like how slick it was and how easily it was to charge cars?
At least it definitely loves to charge cars. I'd say the first struggle was really getting the state of charge monitoring. Because of the LFP battery chemistry, you have a really flat voltage profile. So you really have to monitor that with a shunt, sort of that's counting the current that's going in and out of the battery. And getting a shunt that's well calibrated that can monitor that state of charge isn't terribly easy. So the first one that I was using wasn't doing it right. So I was kind of flying blind at times. I'd be plugging in, charging, and then voltage would start dropping really fast at the lower end of charge, and then it would cut out, right? So being able to monitor that state of charge more specifically, that was a big challenge at the start.
Sweet. Yeah. Well, last question for you. Other than charging cars, can you access this power for anything else that's off-grid?
Yeah, at least it's basically a generator that's set up specifically for EV charging. So,
oh, there's some other plugs in here?
Yeah, so there's the EVSE, right, of course, that's going to be powering your J-plug. In here, there's a NEMA 1450 two-phase outlet.
Okay.
So it effectively can provide two-phase power at the same power rate as the EV charger for any sort of other need. This isn't really an in-use cover, unfortunately. This isn't sort of if it's raining, you wouldn't want to open this guy up.
Uh-huh.
But it's low profile enough that I was able to cover it up. This guy is in use. This is just a GFCI 15-amp, 120-volt dual-gang outlet here. So this is like your courtesy plug, your auxiliary plug if you want 120 volts. And I have used that at times at events like this to show it off. And I've actually cooked some hot dogs with it, actually.
Nice.
Yeah.
Right on. Well, thank you, Jeremy. I really appreciate it.
Yeah. Yeah. Thanks for watching, everybody. Thanks for your interest. And check me out online if you want to learn more.
Check out the description. We'll link him there.
Sounds great.